This is a robot, a toy. He's alive and well. He can show emotions. Be happy, sad, and cry, just like us humans. He can mimic us, repeat what we say. He is man-made, but made how? The first step was concept design. Each part of the body was sketched. And then, a prototype was manufactured from a thermoplastic material. He was equipped with tiny motors, electronic sensors to give him mobility, appropriate microphone and a speaker, a rechargeable battery, a microprocessor, and requisite software to go with all that hardware. All that is necessary. A little rascal is born. Let's see what happens when we push this button. Will he make sound? How will he react to an outside stimulus? Will it move his arms? Here we have sensors, a motor, a power source, and software. Complete works. The software enables the rascal perfect animation. Let's take a look at us, the humans. The human software is inside the cell. Here is a model of a cell. The software makes up the nucleus. This makes us, humans, very much like robots. Any computer student can solve the robot's software. They can write something similar. But human software is extraordinarily complex.
To look
Bill Gates, an icon in high technology world, in his book, points out the superiority of human software.
Human DNA is like a computer program, but far, far more advanced than any software ever created.
These are DNA models. Each of these is called nucleotide. Here we have adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine. There are 3 billion genes in the human gene map like these. This is Encyclopedia Universalis, French version of Britannica, comprised of 30 volumes. There are an average of 10,000 letters on each page. Each volume consists of roughly 1,000 pages. Thus, there are 10 million letters in each volume. In other words, there are 300 volumes of information in the cell nucleus, 10x the volume of all of these volumes. So why is so much information needed? Because each human is unique. Specific differences are in the millions. Writing this BateWare ID, no small task. What would happen if one word was wrong in all this information? I open a page. If there was a correction in this word, if it were written incorrectly, or if this paragraph and that paragraph were replaced, or if these pages change places. This was the software of this robot. If this code is replaced by that code, or if I delete a code, the robot's behavior will change and some parts will malfunction. Human life begins with a single cell. The sperm fertilizes the egg, and a single cell is born. Cells multiply geometrically by copying of the DNA. With each division, DNA is copied. Soon, it reaches 3 billion pairs. It takes a super photocopier to accomplish this. Currently, we see 30 volumes. Tomorrow, we will see 60 volumes, that there are 30 more volumes. Say what? You think someone else put these volumes here? Because in order to reproduce these volumes, we have to either photocopy them or reprint with a printer. This here was the first cell. A second cell emerged identical to the first one. Creation is taking place right before our eyes. This can be nothing but a miracle. Creation out of nothing. Copying takes place as if there were printing presses in every cell. The creation of a human being is like this. Let's say these volumes are copies of the DNA of a baby's first cell. After 9 months, replicated into millions, been replicated billions of times. In other words, a copy is made. The first cell contains 300 volumes of data by trillions of times multiplication. I have here a color photocopy of the software of this robot. Some colors are faded, some letters are missing. look like the software is corrupted, or maybe mutations took place. If this software is installed on a new robot, a slew of errors will occur. Robots' actions will be incongruent to expectations. That's why it is so important that the all 3 billion letters that make up DNA are not copied correctly. What happens when DNA is not copied correctly? Let's give a couple of examples. Consider these volumes DNA. I'm taking a volume from here. For example, on this page that contains the gene code for the CFTR protein, a gem like this. If this base pair is deleted, cystic fibrosis would occur. As a result of its deletion, the transition is closed when there is no CFTR protein. It causes serious problems in the respiratory and digestive systems. Let's say right here in that page, there is the HBB beta globin gene. A single base pair change in this leads to sickle cell anemia. This aberration causes deformation of red blood cells, turns them into sickle shapes from the normal to take on a sickle shape. Change in shape leads to lower the oxygen carrying capacity. Another mistake in this gene causes Mediterranean anemia. Their treatment depends on deciphering the gene map. That's why it took so many years to examine DNA, which consists of 3 billion base pairs. In 1989, a team of scientists in 20 labs around the globe started working under the leadership of James Watson. After a decade of intensive study, significant by the year 2000, great progress had been made in the human genome. And then US President Bill Clinton announced this to the world.
The generous support of the Wellcome Trust, more than 1,000 researchers across 6 nations have revealed nearly all 3 billion letters of our miraculous genetic code. I congratulate all of you on this stunning and humbling achievement. Today, we are learning the language in which God created life. We are gaining ever more awe for the complexity, the beauty, the wonder of God's most divine and sacred gift.
Professor Francis S. Collins directed the Genome Project after 1993. Collins is a scientist who devoted his life to study of the DNA.
It's a happy day for the world. It is humbling for me and awe-inspiring to realize that we have caught the first glimpse of our own instruction book, previously known only to God.
He later published his findings in a book titled The Language of God. He elucidates the nature of the DNA language.
For me, the experience of sequencing the human genome and uncovering this most remarkable of all texts was both a stunning scientific achievement and an occasion of worship. Many will be puzzled by these sentiments, assuming that a rigorous scientist could not also be a serious believer in a transcendent God. This book aims to dispel that notion by arguing that belief in God can be an entirely rational choice, and that the principles of faith are, in fact, complementary with the principles of science.
The software for this toy robot is around 50 pages. There is 50,000 times more information in each of our cells. People can produce these robots because they are created with extraordinary software. There are those among scientists who do not agree with Francis Collins. They say that DNA software was evolved by chance over millions of years. Famous
also has a book
scientist
on this subject,
Richard Dawkins, The Selfish Gene. This is what happens when God's creation is ignored. Failure to acknowledge God's creativity would force us to give it to each of the millions of genes. Dawkins says,
read the Old Testament, I think you would have to agree.
We are survival machines, robot vehicles, blindly programmed to preserve the selfish molecules known as genes.
He doesn't deny it. There is a robot, a machine, a program. But all of this is done blindly, with eyes closed. Dawkins further argues, the human DNA has no particular purpose, and says,
throughout this book, I have emphasized that we must not think of genes as conscious, and it has been convenient, purposeful agents. Blind natural selection, however, makes them behave rather as if they were purposeful, and it has been convenient, as a shorthand, to refer to genes in the language of purpose.
Dawkins acknowledges the perfection in the DNA's architectural structure, then he denies the existence of an architect.
Incidentally, there is, of course, no architect. The DNA instructions have been assembled by natural selection.
There is an architectural structure, but no architect. What a logic. Did it happen by itself? For a human being to take the software of his life for granted is to disrespect to his creator, as well as failure to recognize his own value among the living. This attitude also means acknowledging one's own true value.